Okay, so real quick announcements. Restrooms are down the wildlife building. The front door does not work, but you go into the side door. Okay. The ground, as you'll see, is rough, so if we take a walk out in the orchard after lunch, just be careful where you step because the ground is uneven. We also have fire ants. So the fire ants will not be in the grass, but they will be in the bare ground next to the trees, so just be careful where you're walking. I sprayed most of them yesterday, but there's always some I didn't get. So just be mindful of that. Watch where you're walking. Okay, so we're going to start off with Chair Gailey. She's going to do a welcome for us.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. On behalf of Alamance County, thank you for coming out today for the dedication of this Buster Sykes Farm and Forest Agricultural Demonstration Center. Just briefly, I was thinking about today and coming out to the teaching orchard, and I thought of the song Good Yellow Taxi by Joni Mitchell. If y'all remember that, that's the song that says they took all the trees and put them in a tree museum and charged the people a buck and a half just to see them. And this is not a tree museum. This is a teaching orchard. This is a place where people can come to learn about trees and take that knowledge back to their farms, back to their homes, and continue to enjoy trees on their own property. I also was thinking about a poem by Philip Larkin called The Trees, and I took you a while to share it with you today. So I was thinking about trees and what's so special about them. The trees are coming into leaf like something almost being dead. The recent buds relax and spread. Their greenness is a kind of grief. Is it that they are born again and we grow old? No, they die too. Their yearly trick of looking you is written down in rings of grain. Yet still the unresting tassels thresh in full-grown thickness every May. Last year is dead, they seem to say. Begin afresh, afresh, afresh. And this poem made me think about how, you know, trees do spring new every May. And they remind us of new life and potential and hope. And you know, we seem like we just grow old every year. And it's just amazing to have trees around us where we can enjoy them and observe the spread of their arms, their welcome. Trees don't discriminate. Everybody is welcome to the tree. And I just appreciate the opportunity that we have through the work of so many people today to come and admire these trees and enjoy them and think about the future with them. So next we have Rhett Davis, who's going to talk about farm history and the forestry education program. So here's Rhett.
Okay, Mark said that you're running a little late, you have to catch up. You know what that meant, don't you? He also told me, blessed are the brief, for they shall be invited back. I have waited 15 years for this day. It's been a long time coming. It's for two reasons. It's a dream fulfilled for Buster Sykes, the owner of this farm. It is a promise kept by Rhett Davis to be sure we lived up to the agreement of this gift. And today, it comes into fruition. It's been 15 years to come to this point, and I'm just so excited that I'm here today to see this come into fruition. Buster Sykes came into my office in 2003. He walked in, he was 80-some years old, and he said, Red, I want to give you my farm. I was excited. I looked at my code of ethics and said, darn it, I can't take it. And I said, Buster, why did you want to give me your farm? Because he said, I'm sad to see all the development going around this piece of property. I have a stack of realtor cards this tall and developer cards that tall on my TV set from all the people who want to buy this and put homes on it. And he says, it saddens me greatly to see my farm turn into a housing development. He was raised in a house about 150 yards behind you here in the woods. The Wildlife Depot is there right now. It was an old house, dilapidated. We tore it down. The bricks are over here in the woods. But he was born on this property, and he farmed it all his life. In fact, Rex told me they farmed peanuts out here in the front Now, the time I visited him was in the back where he raised the strawberries. He said, "Rhett, I know that you can save this farm and do something with it." So I contacted NC State, of course, that's who I work for, in the county of Alamance. I said, "What can we do? Can we put this in some type of a land conservancy and a gift to the university and turn this into the gift?" But the gift comes with strings attached. And the strings were, this gift had to be used for education of children, of youth and adults, not only on farming, but on forestry and the stewardship of our natural resources. And he says, "If you can't do that, then I'll find somebody else that can." I said, "You've come to the right agency, because we're an education agency." And so the gift is an educational gift, and it has just taken time to come to this point today. And I said, "We can fulfill that dream." So it was donated in 2005 to NC State with an agreement that this is what is going to happen. Buster and I walked over this property several times and showed me where fields used to be that have grown up in weeds and briars and sweet gums and all the above from when he had quit farming. We walked the woods, which were in pretty good state of deterioration from storms and age and all the things that gets trees. And so we had to reclaim it, we had to bring it back into production again and to make it a beautiful place like it is today. So we went to Billy Locke. Billy, raise your hand there, consultant forester out of Greensboro, and said, "Billy, come over here and appraise this timber and let's put it on the market and let's generate some income for this property so we can get started." And he did. Billy appraised it, marketed it, sold it to the highest bidder. It did extremely well, and we raised a lot of money, which is now held by the university, that we draw upon to do these things out here. So it is planted back. There's maybe 125 acres of 10-year-old pines back there. There's an island back there with over 100-year-old timber on it. It's never, well, I'll say it's never been cut, but it hadn't been cut in 100 years. It's beautiful. It's down there by the creek. In that creek, there's a sluice on that creek. Buster stood me there and showed it to me. He said this sluice was put in during the Revolutionary War, and it ran a sawmill here to supply lumber for the armies, whatever they needed. So there's a lot of history on this property. And it's we've got mixed stands of hardwoods and pines, a wonderful road system back there in the back, which you won't probably enjoy today. But it's a beautiful natural resource project going on back there, and extremely proud of the way it is today. And Billy, thank you for helping us get this started. I want to be sure that I thank those that continued the vision after I retired. I retired in 2007, and Roger Cobb took over the leadership of this facility, and then when he retired, Mark Danley has, and I give Mark Danley and his committee credit for bringing it into fruition today, and the committee's here, and I'm sure you'll introduce them, but this committee has stuck with me for 15 years on seeing this happen, so I'm just so thankful it is. So today is a reality for Buster Sykes, it's a reality for me, and it's a reality for Alamance County and this community. This will be the next Duke Forest. When this is all surrounded by homes and houses, this will be the green spot, the beauty spot in Mebane, which is one of the fastest growing communities in North Carolina. And also in the Piedmont, where we rank as number one and the loss of farmland in the United States. So we've saved it, and it's beautiful, and I look forward to many years ahead and to watch this jewel come into fruition. So, thank you very much for being here today. Enjoy it, and I'll turn it back over to Mark.
Get my notes out there. So, I want to start by saying we need to thank Rhett Dates. I don't know. And Dr. Bonanno might could help me with this, but this doesn't just happen all the time. People just don't come in and donate farms like this, but I think it's a testimony to Rhett and what he did that we now have this farm. So I'm going to start with thank yous, and I know I'm going to leave somebody out, but I'm going to try and get as many as I can. So I'm going to start with Rhett, of course, and then our committee from Raleigh. So Dr. Bonanno, Dr. Yoder, Steve Longwell, Dave Monks is here today. Dr. Mike Parker, who's our tree fruit specialist. Mike was injured in a pruning accident last week. He couldn't come. But this was Mike's vision. He had a demonstration orchard in Garner, and we looked at that. We were trying to think what we could do with this property, and this was his suggestion that we could do this, and I think it's going to turn out very well. Of course, our county advisory committee, and then our Buster Sykes committee, so that's going to be Bill Locke, Jackie Cole over there, Lynn Mosley, Dick Fisher, and Rhett. So they've given me a lot of advice on what we need to do and how to maintain this. Also had a lot of help from Brad Moore, Soil Conservation. I can't tell you how many times we laid off those roads out there. I wanted everything to be straight and square, and we'd lay them out, and we'd get to the far side of the fence, and it would be off by a foot. And we'd go back and start over again. I don't know how many times we pulled a tape measure out there, but I'll tell you, those roads are straight. And everything is just right. I'm proud of that. Of course, the master gardeners have been a great help out here. There's no way I can maintain all of this myself. We got a lot of work yet to do, but they've been very helpful so far, especially Eddie and Pam Love, wherever they are. Eddie and Pam. So they came one weekend last March of 2017. And dug holes for a lot of these peach and apple trees with their digging machines, saving a lot of time with the shovel. I appreciate that. Of course, the Alamance County Extension staff, everybody has had a part in this in some way or the other. And last but not least, I do need to thank my wife, Heidi. So she's my weekend help. She drives the Gator Y spray. She helped put up the shade things over the pawpaw trees. She helped me move the storage container back there. She was a tractor driver, which was fine until she started to pick it up and the back tires came up off the ground on the tractor. Just a few inches, and she got excited about that. But it was okay. We made it work, so that was fine. As we're talking about what to do out here, we thought, you could do field crops and just not enough open land to do soybeans or tobacco, whatever. And we talked about livestock, and Lauren didn't want to come out of here every day to tend to chickens or whatever. And so it seemed like this is really going to be the best way to go. We have a orchard map. There's a map of the entire farm here with proposed activities and structures for the future. We have pictures of Mr. Sykes, so we have pictures of activities that have happened out here so far. The orchard it's about 310 plants, 15 species, 60-some different varieties of trees out there. Primarily, we're going to teach pruning and training. People buy fruit trees and take them home and plant them and not really know how to prune them properly to get the best growth out of them. We're also going to take data on when trees bloom. So people will buy fruit trees and they see in the fruit tree catalog, hardy to zone 7. That's fine. But if it blooms in February, you'll probably never get fruit. And if you don't care about that, that's fine. But we know that we had one of our plums bloom the 1st of March. There are no plums on that tree. So we'll record that data over the next few years and see. So if 6 out of 10 years, if you don't get a plum, you need to know that it's a pretty tree, but you won't get fruit off of it, most likely. Talk about fruit thinning, variety selection, all the different rootstocks out there, what'll grow here, what won't grow here, what from rootstock. One thing we're real excited about, one of the bonuses, at some point in time, we're going to make some fruit. Probably not much this year, but some in the following years. And as we do, then our plan is to donate that fruit to allied churches, food pantries, places like that. There are lots of children, especially, that never had fresh fruit. If you've never had a tree ripe peach, it's a delight. And we hope to share that with other people. And going forward, then we're also looking for partners. So we intend to partner with Alamance Community College. They've got a farm around the corner over there. And we talked to Justin and Liz and said, we can have fruit trees and small fruit here. And if they do turf plots over there, we can just trade back and forth. We both have the mission of education to the public, mm-hmm. And that's what we tend to do. We'll continue to partner with Alamance Soil and Water, Hope in the future we'll partner with Farm Bureau, Wildlife Commission, the Forest Service, lots of people that we can partner with going forward. So what we learned so far. So the first thing I learned that drilling a well is exciting. Because they're charging $10 a foot, and he doesn't really care if he gets water or not. So they started drilling the well back there, and I'm out here working the orchard, and I'm kind of nervous about this, and he's drilling and drilling, and I don't see any water. And he gets about 400 feet, and there's some water coming out, but not a lot. He said, we probably got 10, 15 gallons. He said, that's a good well. I said, well, that's a good well for a house, but I need like 40 gallons a minute to water the orchard. And he said, well, I don't have a 600 feet of pipe on my truck. So he got down about 450, and he was up probably at, say, maybe 30 gallons a minute. Well, that's not bad. I said, let's just go ahead and go to 500. That's a good, even number. Makes the bill any easier. So he went that one drill. I look back, and there's water coming out of the ground like he hit a water main. They're smiling, and I'm smiling. They come up there, and he said, you got close to 100 gallons a minute. Oh, he's going to stamp it at 50, but you got close to 100 gallons a minute, which works very well. Other thing we learned is peach trees grow like weeds. So you can see the peach trees behind me here. They're 1 year old.
Wow.
They were planted as a whip about 24 inches high. That's what they were planted as a year ago. They're now probably 7 feet tall, 7 feet across. They're growing very, very well. Asian pears grow very well too. We do have some peaches, even though they bloomed mid-March, so we may have a peach or two this year. So we're just learning things all the time. We learned last year, I went off to a meeting in June. When I came back, the Japanese beetles had found the orchard almost defoliated the plums and the cherries. I liked them very much. We took care of those. And then sort of wind up here, so our future plans, we've got this field next to us over there. That's actually part of the Wildlife Commission lease, but they don't really care what we do out there. So we've talked about, well, we could plant some pecan trees. They're too big for our orchards. Native persimmons, we might do that. We may do some ornamental trials, so butterfly bushes, red buds. We're just trying to think what we can do. And in the short term, we are going to partner with Soil and Water. They're going to put in the Pollinator Trail annual cover crop, sunflowers, buckwheat,
cowpeas.
Right. So sometime later this month, we'll sow that out there. So that should be very attractive, plus attract a lot of pollinators too. And then further down the line, we may have a permanent woody pollinator demonstration garden. We just have things we can do, tremendous potential out here. It's just going to take time to develop, so that we'll just keep on working on it. So we'll find Taylor to talk about 4-H.
Good morning, everybody. Thank y'all for coming out here tonight, or today. My name is Taylor Jones. I'm the 4-H agent for Alamance County. And I'm just so excited about what we have done and what we're planning on doing with 4-H youth out here in Alamance County at the Buster Sites Farm. I'd like to begin with a story. Back in 2016, Mark took the new 4-H agent on a drive. He began to talk about this 170-acre property that was belonged to Mr. Buster Sites. Then he started to talk about how it was gifted to Cooperative Extension and was used or was intended to be used for 4-H youth development programs and things like that. I wonder what that's doing. So then Mark asked the new 4-H agent, you know, what can 4-H can do out here? And I said, we can do a whole lot out here. And I was just so excited that we had the opportunity to do something like this. Like Rhett was saying, not that this doesn't happen for everybody, and we're really excited Alamance County 4-H has hit the ground running, incorporating the Buster Sykes Farm into our programming. We have had several 4-H clubs, including the Alamance Anglers and the Environmental Science 4-H Club, which Lori Newland is the leader of. She's here today. Most of our programs actually take place back in the open field towards the back of the property and the surrounding forests and the creek and nature trails. We've had everything from tree identification with Dr. Lynn Mosley. We've had our birding with Dr. Lynn Mosley and tree identification in Nature Heights. And we also had our end of summer celebration out here last year, which was a lot of fun. We had over 60 youth and adults out here celebrating 4-H and celebrating the great outdoors. So that's awesome. Another activity that we have done, that Alamance County 4-H has done out here, is the Candid Critter Project. And for those of you who don't know what that is, basically it is a project that allows citizens access to a trail camera type device, and they get to set it up in a certain area and kind of track and see and record what wildlife is in a certain area. So the Environmental Science Club actually participated in that. And we were really excited to see deer and foxes and some pretty funny squirrels too in front of those beavers. So we're really excited about that project, and hopefully, you know, want to do some more of those. We've done a lot out here already, 4-H has, but we have a ton of ideas and dreams and goals we want to do out here. One of the big projects that we want to see is an immersive garden, youth garden, children's garden, with all kinds of different plants, natives, and things like that. So we're really excited about that. And we're just, you know, kind of making a wish list. There's a wish list up here for 4-H and what we want to do out here. We want to incorporate geocaching, low ropes course, a campground, campsite down near our field. And we want to continue to develop the trails for walking, nature trails for walking and a horseback ride eventually. And maybe even put in a pond for some fisheries and invertebrates and different environmental and wildlife studies as well. So we've got lots of plans, lots of dreams, but we're super excited to have the opportunity to be here. And we appreciate your support. Something like this doesn't happen overnight. We need folks like you, like everybody's here today, in order to make something like this happen. And without you guys and your support and everybody that Mark mentioned, you know, 4-H or this would never be possible. So thank you for your support, and I think I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Rich Bonanno, Director of North Carolina Cooperative Extension.
Awesome. Thanks, Taylor. It's a pleasure to be here on behalf of Dean Linton and the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences at North Carolina State University. I want to welcome you all here today. I thank everyone. I did get a chance to talk to Buster's nephew here. He wanted to just come and see what was going on. He did reminisce about the peanuts that used to be planted here and about the homestead that was just down the road. Thanks, of course, to Mark and all his staff for helping to make this possible. And Rhett, I'm so glad that I wasn't driving up here and see a sign that says Rhett's peach and strawberry pick your own operation. But you did read the ethics rules, and we are very appreciative of that. And I also want to thank the county commissioners, Amy Gailey here as chair of the county commissioners, for all their support. As you know, or as you may know, Extension is a cooperative enterprise between the federal government, the state government, and county government. And it wouldn't exist with all three. And a real quick land grant history, just so some of you that may not be aware, we're called land grant universities, NC State and also NCA&T, because when the Morrill Act was passed in 1862 and then the second Morrill Act in 1890, which then created the historically black universities like A&T, Congress appropriated land to be sold to create the dollars to make the universities. Our land was actually in Nebraska,
because there was no federal land for the federal government to give us here in North Carolina. It wasn't the land that the university is on. It was land to create the university. So the idea was, for every member of Congress that a state had, so two senators plus however many congressmen, I can't tell you how many that was in 1862, but let's say it was 10, 30,000 acres of federal land was appropriated per member of Congress per state. So if we had 10 people, that would have been 300,000 acres that came from Nebraska, and it was sold to homesteaders for $1.25 an acre. It was a set amount of money. And that money was the money that was created, was put together to actually create the university. That's what the land grant, what they're talking about. It isn't about the land we farm or the land we do research on, it's about the land we sold to homesteaders to create the universities. So extension is a very critical piece of all of our land grant institutions. Teaching at the undergraduate and graduate level, research, which is the creation of new knowledge, and extension, which is the extension of that research-based knowledge to the public, which really helps create prosperity and makes it all work. I just want to also briefly introduce, I have Dr. Mike Yoder with me. He's one of my associate directors of extension. Mike's in charge of 4-H in North Carolina, and Dr. David Monks. David is associate director of research and works for my counterpart, Dr. Steve Wommel, who's the director of research at NC State. So this is a combined effort. The extension you see here is about what we've already done and being able to educate the public. But the research component that comes along with this is all the information that comes into making the right choices to be able to teach the public. So when Mike Parker came out and sat down with Mark and they figured out what they were going to plant, all that was really based on a lot of research, a lot of understanding about what would grow well here, what wouldn't grow well here, the timings of planting, and how we could really make this enterprise work well. So when we brought the public in, we brought farmers in, that we have the right information to share with them. And finally, just quickly on the vision for the site, what's great, people want to give us land all the time, and it's great to get land, but what made this piece special is this piece came with bank accounts. Okay. Because of that vision going back to Buster and Rhett, and then having this property logged and creating that bank account, it allowed us to be able to come in and Mark to come in with the county and actually create something. Because it's difficult, we don't just have pots of money lying around and we can just like put up that fence and get the guy to go to 500 feet so we get 100 gallons of water and all the other things, the gator, all of these things that happen around here to sort of make this all work. This isn't something that we can normally do with property. And sometimes we get a piece of property and we're stuck with it and we're not quite sure what to do. And a lot of times people don't have a vision about what they'd like to see. A realistic vision that comes with the dollars to do it. And Buster, along with Rhett, created that vision to really make this all possible. So when we sat down with Mark, and so the board here is basically the county extension director, the director of research, and the director of extension, kind of sit down and do the decision. So we're doing the fence and the well and the sign and the tractor and all of the things that we did, it was a collaborative effort in making those decisions, but we knew we had the resources to do it, even before we started partnering with other people to potentially bring some additional income into this property. So the vision to be able to have that and have the dollars to do it really was the key, so that we could then go ahead and have this agricultural piece, have this forestry component, and of course have this great potential here for 4-H and youth development with the shooting sports program that we're hoping to develop on this property. All of that really comes together, and I'll tell you, it takes a lot of foresight and persistence and real vision to make that happen. And this is one of the best examples in the state for this to be here. And everything that everybody said about this county and the development and all that, all the more reason to have sanctuaries like this and have the ability to educate the public. And even if that public is coming here to figure out how to prune their own trees, there's still a connection to agriculture. We want to make sure as we move forward in the state, and there's parts of the state that become more urbanized, that people move in from out of the state, that they have an appreciation for the state that they're moving into and the agricultural heritage of the state we're moving into. And in fact, the agriculture is still the number one industry in the state. And if it wasn't for all those farmers and all those people dedicated to land preservation, the production of food, the production of fiber, production of wood products, then we would not be able to survive. I try to remind people all the time that the rural people
will survive just fine without the cities, but the city people will not survive without the rural people. And so all of that has to be connected. And we get to the point where we bring homeowners in and they have those fruit trees in their yard, they get to then be able to enjoy those fruits, have that connection to agriculture, but also have that appreciation for agriculture that allows all of us in agriculture to continue to survive and thrive in the state. So with that, I am going to turn it back over to Amy Galey, who'll come up and return thanks before lunch. Thank you.
If you care to, please bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, we just take this time to thank you and celebrate the life and legacy of Buster Sykes, Lord, and the vision that he had and the generosity of his spirit. And we thank you for all the people who worked so hard to put this project together. And we ask that you bless the project and the people over the years who come to it, who learn, who grow, and who enjoy the blessings that you've given to us, Lord. And we just ask that you bless this food for the nourishment of our bodies and our bodies to your service. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.